We're Blind Melon. I'm Christopher Thorne.
I'm Glenn Graham.
I'm Shannon Hoon.
Brad Smith.
Roger Stevens.
And you're watching
Sony Music TV. Right now.
With Blind Melon.
I moved out here in like 1989 or 90 to Los Angeles, and through a friend who knew of a band who needed a singer, I met Brad and Rogers, who are both from Mississippi, and they had lived out here for like a year or two prior to when I came out here. And Brad was friends with Christopher through the folk scene out here, and that's how us four got together. And then we needed a drummer, and we looked around out here for a drummer, but we couldn't find anybody who wasn't into the heavy metal scene, you know, a lot of heavy metal drummers. And so they said that they knew this guy back home that they didn't know how if he wanted to come out to LA or not, because he doesn't really like how to get the feeling. He doesn't like the big city or anything that it has to offer. But anyway, he came out, and he was the perfect for the thing, and it was, you know, he had a lot of ideas and stuff that we all kind of, you know, we knew he was the right guy. And so it was, I don't know how long ago it was, but it's been good ever since.
Well, there's just, I mean, where we're from, there were no other musicians, you know, which is, I'm sure, a similar background from Christopher's. Like, there's, you know, it's a small town, and there's nobody around doing what you're doing, and there's not very much of an outlet to be creative. I mean, if you're anywhere to the left of the right wing or whatever, it's a really hard place to exist. So, and you know, we wanted to do what we're doing. We wanted to get a record deal and make an album, you know, and go out and play around the world or whatever. So it's like, I got out of high school, and rather than going to college, I just decided I might as well just go for it. So I moved out.
You know what, that comes from everybody having different influences, you know? I mean, there's no certain, I mean, I don't dominate the sound of the band, you know? No one dominates any direction that this band's going. It's just everybody pointing an arrow in a different direction, you know, and putting everything that, like, whatever the other guy's influences are, most of them aren't the same as mine, and most of theirs aren't the same as anybody else's in the band. So when you put it all together, it's like everybody's still, I can still take what I've learned from Jim Croce or Elton John or Syd Barrett or whoever and mix it in with what these guys are doing, and it kind of comes out unique, you know? We were band nameless. It was like, we were just writing songs. We didn't really spend a lot of time on thinking of a band name. And one day Brad came into the studio where we were practicing at, and he just yelled out the name Blind Melon in the room, and everybody asked him what it was about. And when he told the story, which I'll let him tell you when you talk to him, it just stuck, and we all just kept it. And it's now our band name. It surely fits.
I mean, I knew these guys before. You know, I'd known Rogers and Brad. I knew Brad more. But, I mean, Shannon was definitely, you know, when I met him, I knew. You know, he's like he did for Rogers. He sang some acoustic songs, and you know, I was blown away. I knew that I wanted to work with Shannon and Rogers and Brad and well, at the time it wasn't Glenn, but I knew it would work. You know, Shannon's like my favorite singer. He has an amazing voice. I wouldn't ask for another singer.
Set!
We all moved to North Carolina after we had signed to Capitol, and about 4 or 5, 6 months after we had signed, or actually it was longer than that, it was about a year. That just goes to show how your time frame gets all screwed up out here for someone like myself. But we all moved to North Carolina, and we got this big 5-bedroom house. We all lived in it together, and that was a chance for, like, you know, we had all met in LA, and it's so distracting out here that, you know, you have to worry about your rent at the end of the month, you have to worry about making all these ends meet. You don't really get a chance to get to know one another, establish any kind of unity. And we all moved to North Carolina and in a real peaceful setting, and the environment down there was, you know, it was a chance to really get to know one another. And that was when we really became, like, you know, best friends with one another, and realizing that we were in a band with people who you could learn from. You know, it's like, as far as myself, I learned from these guys something every day, if not from one, from another person. And, you know, it made everything better when we moved to North Carolina. We all lived together. It's like, if you had any kind of problem if you had any kind of run-in with someone, you know, about anything, you resolved it right there, because 5 minutes later you were going to see the guy down in the kitchen.
Well, part of it, I mean, is learning that you are, in our case, 1/5 of the picture, okay? I mean, you can break it down into, you know, the melodic lead instruments or whatever, and then the rhythm section, or however I choose to look at it, like 5 separate things. But I mean, everybody has their little space to fill, and you should weave together rather than trying to outplay or fill too many spaces. You know, learn to use silence as, you know, not playing as part of your playing. You know, I mean, not you know, just letting it happen rather than trying to, you know, force this. It's with the drums, this is the song, it's a drum song or bass song or whatever, you know, just.
You know what, we kept it as raw and as organic as possible, you know. I mean, the guys record all the music live, you know. They all go in there and on any given day, you know, they got 2 or 3 songs done in one day, so it makes everything a lot more, you know, it just seems so unnatural to go in and do the drums and come back in and do the bass and come in and do one guitar track, and then come in and do it. That might be the way some people like to do it, but as far as the you know, the way we play, it's like, it just sounds a lot tighter, it sounds a lot more natural live, as far as the music goes.
We got this guy to help us get what we wanted, since we don't know all the technical aspects of the studio, but we know what we hear in our heads, we just don't know how to get it, is the big thing. And he did have some guidance. I think Rick Parasher was our producer, and the big thing that he did more than anything is just like a quality control thing. You know, we were getting a little too far out there, maybe he just kind of knocked us back on track, and, you know, we just moved forward. He kept things moving. He was the type of person to say, okay, that's enough for that take, let's move on to something else. You got it, you got it, you got it. You know, we're like, oh, do you think we got it? And he's like, yeah, you got it, let's go. You know, so the kind of production deal that we did was not like, he was not God in the studio, so to speak. You know, he helped us a lot.
I think that we tried to get we wanted to make sure that it came off live, because we played all of the tracks. We played all of the instruments live with minor overdubs. And we wanted to make sure that they had energy, leave all the mistakes on it, make sure it's rough around the edges and sounds like we're playing it.
Exactly. We wanted it to sound like as if you were, you know, if you were sitting there in between us, like I said, in the earphones. I mean, if you were there live, you'd see me on the left, you'd see Rogers on the right. So on the record, when you're listening to it, it has that feel as well. You know, you can hear him coming up over here or me coming up over here.